Today, I'm going to show you the best way to get started with password managers and simplify your personal security. When I first started out, it was so overwhelming trying to remember the login info for everything. I ended up recycling and reusing the same credentials, which is a huge risk, since one compromise could lead to all of them getting hacked. But by using a password manager, I can generate unique logins for each account in an encrypted database. Best of all, I now only have to memorize a single strong password to secure everything. In this video, I'm going to take you step by step in setting up my password manager of choice. We'll go through generating a strong master key, the workflow for using it on a daily basis, and cover some options for using password managers on multiple devices. Stay tuned. My password manager of choice is KeepassXC. It's a free and open source fork of the original Keepass, but under more active development. It works on Windows, Linux, and macOS. Using an offline manager like KeepassXC gives me full control over the password database and forces me to access it only on devices that I own and trust. Now, some of you might wonder if using a password manager is like putting all your eggs in one basket. Well, the alternative is putting each egg in many baskets, except when you lose a basket, you still lose all your eggs. You should treat your password database more like a bank vault that requires special attention to how you secure it. Unless you can memorize long, random passwords for every single account, you're probably gonna recycle predictable ones for everything. You might also wonder, why not just use your web browser to remember your passwords for you? Well, flip that logic around. Why would you wanna use your password manager to browse the web? Browsers have a long history of storing your passwords insecurely and are also quite vulnerable to attack, since they're first to be exposed to malicious code on websites. The best practice in cybersecurity is to separate the roles of your software. Use the browser for browsing and a password manager for passwords. With that being said, let me show you how to get started. So first, let's navigate to KeepassXC. Click on the download button and select the right one for your operating system. It's always important to verify the integrity of the download file whenever possible to ensure you're not getting a maliciously tampered installer. To do this, download the checksum file. For instructions on how to verify the installer, scroll down and click on the verify link. On Windows, open up PowerShell, navigate to the directory you downloaded it, copy the command, and paste it with right-click or Shift-Insert. On macOS or Linux, open up a terminal and do the same thing. The checksum file contains a SHA-256 hash of the installer. If you want to verify the integrity and authenticity of the file, download KeepassXC's public key and the installer's PGP signature. Import the public key and use GPG to verify the signature. Verifying authenticity ensures that even if KeepassXC's website was hacked to serve a false checksum for a tampered installer, the attacker would still not be able to create a false signature. He'd have to steal the KeepassXC team's private key to do this. We'll install the application and open it. You should allow the program to check for updates on startup to ensure you always have the latest security patches. Create a new database, and we'll give it a name and description reflecting the name of the computer you'll be using it on. Let's click on Advanced Settings to set the security configuration. For the encryption algorithm, each one of these choices is excellent. AES, also known as Rijndael, has stood the test of time under cryptanalysis and can benefit from hardware acceleration and CPUs that support the AES NI instruction set, though it's less important on small files like a password database. Twofish was developed by the legendary cryptographer and technologist Bruce Schneier. It was a competition finalist to become AES, but Rijndael was chosen because of some speed advantages. I personally use ChaCha20, which is a more modern encryption algorithm than AES and Twofish. It was developed by another genius cryptographer, Daniel Bernstein. Google adopted ChaCha20 as the algorithm of choice for Android devices, for storage encryption, and TLS encryption to their websites. It's also used in the latest Linux kernel to generate random data. We'll use Argon2 to hash your master password and benchmark a 1-second delay for your computer. Argon2 is incredibly strong and was the winner of the password hashing competition in 2015. A hashing algorithm turns your plain text password into a unique, fixed-length key that can be used for encryption. A 1-second delay means it takes the algorithm 1 second to generate the hash. If you're using a password of, say, 80 bits in strength, this means 2 to the 80th seconds, or 3.8 quadrillion years for someone to brute force the password on your computer. A 2-second delay doubles that. Obviously, if your database is stolen and being attacked on a cluster of specialized hardware, this cracking time goes down significantly. That's why you need a long, high-entropy password and can't rely just on a hashing algorithm. Let's make a strong master key using the passphrase method. If you like to select words using a true random number generator, grab some dice and a word list from the Electronic Frontier Foundation's website. There's also a link to it in the description. Suppose we roll the numbers 32362. The first word in our passphrase would be glowing. If pseudorandom is good enough for you, we can just use KeepassXC's built-in generator. The word separator can be empty or any symbol. It doesn't really add much additional strength to the passphrase, just makes it easier to read. How many words should you use? I personally use a 128-bit master password to future-proof advances in computing power. This requires 10 words. For most people though, you can use 7 words. It gives us 90 bits of entropy, which is stronger than a 14-character random mix. You can slowly work your way up to this by starting off with just 3 words as your passphrase. Then over the course of the next month, tack on a random word each week until you're there. Write this passphrase down and hide it in a lockbox somewhere for safekeeping. You never know when you'll forget it one day for some reason. For your grandmother with poor memory, write it down for her in a notebook to keep in a purse. When it comes to security, simplicity is usually the best option. I learned this the hard way, having locked myself out of my data more than once, since I never bothered writing down the passphrase. There's also additional options of using a key file or YubiKey programmed in challenge response mode as a second factor to decrypt your database. To do this, just plug it in and select the challenge response slot. I recommend using a YubiKey if you have one, but remember to make a second copy as well in case you lose the first. If you don't have a YubiKey, you can also generate a key file to store it on a USB stick. Don't store it on the same device as your database, since then it's no longer a two-factor. Backup the key file to another drive, since if it gets corrupted or deleted, you'll be locked out of your passwords for good. After all that's done, save your database to the desktop somewhere. We can create our first entries now. Right-click or press Ctrl+N. We'll add a title, username, password, and URL for LastPass. I like using something ridiculously long from the extended ASCII character set if I can. Some websites limit you to 20 or 30 characters or restrict the symbols you can use. In these cases, you'll have to adjust the generated password accordingly. Some sites may also truncate passwords that are too long without telling you the length limit. Your generated password won't work in this case, and you'll have to password reset and adjust to a shorter one. The notes section is useful for recording information like backup codes, PINs, and security questions. By the way, for security questions, I also recommend you generate a short 2 or 3 word passphrase instead of using something like your mother's real maiden name. This prevents attackers from researching you on the internet and making educated guesses to recover your account. I'll download a favicon for the entry to make it easier to identify. If that fails, you can manually download an ICO favicon by going to the website's home and inspecting the page. Then download and add it as a custom one. The history section lets me review any past changes. So if you generate a new password for an existing entry, the old one will show up here. In the folder tree on the left, we can create groups to organize your password entries. I have hundreds of entries in my database, so making groups is quite useful. If you like searching for entries by text, hit Ctrl+F to search for title, username, or notes. Let's run through the settings now by clicking on the wrench icon. I like to keep the defaults of start only one instance of KeepassXC, remember previously used databases, check for updates once a week. In auto type settings, you can select a keyboard shortcut to automatically fill in fields based on the URL and title of the password entry. I think the default is Ctrl+Shift+V, so we'll set it here. Under security, you can set how long to wait before your password manager auto-locks or clears the clipboard after copying a password. I typically leave the convenience section as default except for don't hide passwords when editing and don't require password repeat when it's visible. Browser integration is a feature that auto-fills password fields for you whenever your database is unlocked. The browser extension connects to your active KeepassXC instance to see if there's any entries that match the URL or title of the web page you're on. For this to work, you need to enable the integration and install the browser plugin. Click OK and restart KeepassXC. Go to the extension and connect it to your password manager. Then when I go to a login or registration page, fields can populate automatically. KeyShare is a feature that lets you export a group of passwords to share with somebody else using KeepassXC. You can enable it for import or export and generate a signing certificate if you want. The signing certificate lets the receiver verify that the shared passwords came from you and weren't tampered with. When you click edit on a password group and go to KeyShare, you can export it to a container file, encrypt it with a password. If you're trying to share a password group with multiple people, use the synchronize option and set the path to a file sitting on a shared network drive. Now that you're familiar with the program, let's talk daily workflow of a password manager. For each of your existing accounts, create a new entry and populate it with a newly generated password. Then log into the account and change it to this password. Whenever you sign up for something new, start by creating the credentials in your manager first. Remember to always make regular backups of your password database to multiple locations, whether it's daily or weekly. If your database file gets lost or corrupted, it can be really hard to recover everything. For using a password manager on mobile devices, there's apps like Keepass DX for Android or Strongbox for iOS that can import your database file. If managing an offline password manager is too much effort for you, consider trying and paying for one of the many online options like 1Password, LastPass, Dashlane, or Bitwarden. These companies provide apps that sync the database between all of your devices and make it quite convenient to use. I personally don't use cloud-based password managers for two reasons. First, the impact of a major compromise or service shutdown is too risky for me, even if the odds are low. LastPass has suffered some minor data breaches in the past, for example, but what if they were major? As centralized sources for people's passwords, these companies are prime targets for criminals to attack. Second, history has shown that encryption only buys you a certain amount of time until we find ways to break the algorithm. Having sole offline custody of my data mitigates this risk. With that being said, if the convenience of cloud-based password managers is more important than any extreme security concerns, by all means, use them. It's much better than nothing at all. One last thing you should know about password managers is that they're vulnerable to malware installed on your computer, which can keylog your master password as you type it in, take screen recordings, or copy your clipboard. If the malware acquires the privileges to access your memory, it can simply extract the decryption key and upload your database without keylogging at all. Now, all of these things apply even if you don't use a password manager. So make sure you're practicing the best security hygiene and consider using virtual machines. But we'll save that for another time. So that's it for password managers and how to get started. If you learned something new from this tutorial, give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and subscribe now. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll leave you with a parting question. What type of password manager do you prefer, online or offline? Let me know why in the comments below. See you soon.